Hi everyone! Today we're going to talk about how to use a convolution integral to solve a second order non-homogeneous differential equation initial value problem. To complete this problem, we'll first find the Laplace transform of our differential equation. Then we'll plug in our initial conditions and solve for y of s. And finally, we'll use a convolution integral to take the inverse Laplace transform and find y of t. Let's take a look. In this particular problem, we've been given the second order non-homogeneous differential equation of 4y double prime plus y is equal to the function g of t. We've also been given the initial conditions y of 0 equals 3 and y prime of 0 equals negative 7. And as I mentioned before, our first step is going to be to take the Laplace transform of our second order non-homogeneous differential equation. The way that we're going to do that is by using this formula for f double prime of t. It's the formula that tells us how to take the Laplace transform of y double prime. But we'll be taking the Laplace transform of each of our terms in our original differential equation, 4y double prime, y, and g of t. So the way that we'll do that is one term at a time. First, 4y double prime. So we'll leave our 4 out in front here, and then the Laplace transform of y double prime by our formula here will be s squared, and since we're dealing with y's instead of f of s, we'll call it capital Y of s minus s times y of 0 minus y prime of 0. And by the formula again, that's our Laplace transform for y double prime. The Laplace transform for y will be y of s. And the Laplace transform for g of t, since we don't know what g of t represents here, we'll only be able to take the Laplace transform as far as calling it g of s. What this will allow us to do is, at the end of our problem, when we find our original function f of t, it'll be in general terms of g of t, and we'll have a general formula into which we can plug in any g of t. Our next step now is going to be to plug in our initial conditions and then solve for capital Y of s. As you can see, we have two initial conditions, y of 0 equals 3, and we have y of 0 down here in our problem, and then we have y prime of 0 equals negative 7, and we have y prime of 0 down here in our problem. I forgot my parentheses. We have y prime of 0 down here in our problem. So we'll be able to make those substitutions. So let's go ahead and do that. We'll have 4 times s squared capital Y of s minus s times y of 0, which we know to be 3, minus y prime of 0, which we know to be negative 7. So we'll go ahead and call that plus 7, plus y of s equals g of s. And remember that we're going to be solving for y of s in terms of g of s. So now we can distribute this 4, we'll call it 4s squared y of s minus, we'll have 3s here, and when we distribute the 4 we'll get 12s, and then plus 28 plus capital Y of s equals g of s. Now we want to group our capital Y of s terms together. We'll get y of s, and we can factor out the y of s and multiply that by 4s squared, which accounts for the first term, plus 1, which accounts for this term right here. And then everything else, we have minus 12s plus 28, so minus 12s plus 28 equals g of s. Now we need to move everything over to the right-hand side except capital Y of s. So first we'll move over the negative 12s plus 28. So we'll call that g of s, not to that step yet, plus 12s minus 28. And now we'll need to divide both sides by 4s squared plus 1 to solve for y of s. So we'll get y of s equals, and while we're here, we should go ahead and rearrange our terms and then just divide each one individually by 4s squared plus 1, because we'll need to break up these fractions in order to perform the inverse Laplace transform. So let's use 12s first. So 12s divided by 4s squared plus 1 minus 28 over 4s squared plus 1 plus g of s over 4s squared plus 1. Now that we're here, we need to prepare to take the inverse Laplace transform of our y of s function in order to try to get to a y of t function. In order to do that, we're going to be using our two formulas up here for the inverse Laplace transform of functions in these forms. So notice that the first formula here is a formula for the inverse Laplace transform of s over s squared plus a squared. Well, we have a couple of fractions down here in our y of s function. Our first one, 12s over s squared plus 1, has an s in the numerator, as does this first formula here. So we're going to be using that first formula for our first fraction. Our second fraction, negative 28 over 4s squared plus 1, only has a constant in the numerator. So we're going to be using this second formula, which just has the constant in the numerator as well. And then our last fraction, g of s over 4s squared plus 1, we'll actually have to use a convolution integral formula for, and that'll be our third formula here for the convolution of f and g, and we'll talk more about that in just a second. Now remember that in order to use these formulas, we'll have to turn our fractions into exactly the same format as our functions here for the inverse Laplace transform. So notice the first formula here in teal has s alone in the numerator and then s squared plus a squared in the denominator. Well, we've got some things that are muddying up our fraction. We need to first of all get the 12 out of there so that s can be by itself in the numerator. We're also going to need to get the 4 out of there to make sure that s squared is by itself in the denominator. And we need to make sure that this second term here, where we have the plus 1, is a square because we have a squared. So we'll do the similar process on the other two fractions, but we'll start with that one. So let's go ahead and say that capital Y of S equals, to attempt to start getting S in the numerator by itself and S squared in the denominator by itself, let's go ahead and divide through everything by 4 so that the S squared in the denominator is alone. So in the numerator, that means we'll have 3S. And in the denominator, that means we'll have s squared plus 1/4. We're going to need to do something similar to both of our other fractions, so we'll go ahead and divide through by 4, and we'll get minus 7 over s squared plus 1/4 plus, we'll call it 1/4 g of s over s squared plus 1/4. So we made some progress because now we have s squared on its own. We also know that 1/4 is the square of 1/2, so we can actually consider a to be 1/2, and a squared, therefore, is 1/2 times 1/2, or 1/4, so we can write that out later. But we still need for our first fraction here to get the s by itself. So what we'll do is we'll pull the s out, the 3 out in front of our fraction to get the s by itself. So we'll have 3 times s over, and we'll call this s squared plus 1/2 squared. So now we can get things in exactly the same format as our formula. Then we'll have minus 7 times, the denominator will still be s squared plus 1/2 squared. But in the numerator, notice, based on our formula, we need to have 1/2 because our formula tells us that this a constant here in the numerator needs to be the same as the a constant right here in the denominator. We know that in our denominator we have 1/2 right here, so we need to somehow get 1/2 into our numerator. Well, the way that we do that is we put the 1/2 in our numerator, but we can't just add 1/2 like that. We have to add a 2 over 1 as well, so that this is like multiplying by 2 over 2, so it's like multiplying by 1, and it doesn't affect our function. But we only want to keep the 1/2, which means that this 2 over 1 right here has to move out in front with the 7. So 2 over 1 is just 2, which means that out in front here we end up with not 7, but 14. And then we can get rid of our 2 over 1 here and just be left with 1/2. So that's how we get that 1/2 in the numerator. Our last fraction here, we actually need to separate into two separate fractions that we can identify as two separate functions of x, so that we can use the convolution integral to take the inverse Laplace transform. So the first thing we'll actually do is we'll pull that 1/4 g of s out in front. So we'll say plus 1/4 g of s, and we'll multiply that by 1 over s squared plus 1/2 squared. 1/2 squared to get that 1/4. Well, we notice now that this 1 over s squared plus 1/2 squared is in the same format as this formula here, right, with the constant in the numerator. So we need to do the same thing that we did with our second fraction, the 7 over s squared plus 1/4. And we need to get 1/2 here in our numerator. So we'll put 1/2 in the numerator, but we also have to multiply by 2 over 1 so that it's like multiplying just by 1. But of course, that means that our 1 times 2 over 1 needs to come out in front so that we're just left with 1/2. So let's go ahead and do that. Instead of this, we'll have plus, we'll bring our 2 over 1 out in front, and this will actually just give us 1/2 out here in front. Then we have times g of s times now 1/2 over s squared plus 1/2 squared. And we'll just get rid of this. Now we can use our formulas to take the inverse Laplace transform of our first two fractions, and we'll use that convolution integral formula to take the inverse Laplace transform of our third fraction here, the 1/2 times g of s times 1/2 over s squared plus 1/2 squared. We know that according to our formula, as long as we have our fraction in this format here, that we can identify that a is 1/2, and therefore turn this into cosine of at, or cosine of 1/2 t. So we'll say here now, we're starting to take the inverse Laplace transform, we'll say that y of t will be equal to cosine of 1/2 t, because we identified here that a was equal to 1/2, and so we plug that into our formula here for cosine of at. And of course, we have to multiply that formula by 3 because we had 3 out in front here. Our second fraction, we know that a is 1/2, and we'll use our formula here for sine of at. So we can write that as minus 14 times sine of 1/2 t. And then our last term, we'll need to use a convolution integral for. And we can't just take the inverse Laplace transform of each of our functions individually and then multiply them together. So even though we could say that the inverse Laplace transform of g of s was g of t, and that the inverse Laplace transform of this fraction here, according to our formula for the inverse Laplace transform of this function here with the constant in the numerator, even though we could say that that was sine of 1/2 t, we can't just take the inverse Laplace transforms individually and then multiply them together. So we have to use our convolution integral formula in order to take the inverse Laplace transform. The way that we'll do that is we'll identify the inverse Laplace transforms individually. So we'll say that the inverse Laplace transform of g of s is equal to, we'll call it g of t, and the inverse Laplace transform will just be g of t. And the inverse Laplace transform, the inverse Laplace transform of our function here, 1/2 over s squared plus 1/2 squared, we'll call f of t, and we'll say that that is equal to sine of 1/2 t. So notice that all we did was we took the inverse Laplace transforms, which we wrote down here, and we just identified that we were going to call these inverse Laplace transforms, give them a function name, g of t and f of t. And the reason that we did that is because our convolution integral formula here tells us that we're going to be convoluting. That's what this notation here means, this star. we're going to be convoluting f of t and g of t. So this notation, f star g of t, means the convolution of f of t and g of t. And the formula is actually really simple. All we're going to do, we got to remember to keep our 1/2 out in front here. So we'll say plus 1/2, and the rest of it is just here, g of t and f of t multiplied together. So this is where our integral starts here, our convolution integral. So 1/2 times the integral from 0 to t of f of t, which we know is just sine of 1/2 t. So sine of 1/2 t times g of t minus tau. And since our g of t function is just g of t, all we have to do is substitute t minus tau for t. So we'll actually just call this g of t minus tau, d tau. And one important thing to remember here is that you can actually substitute t minus tau into either one of your functions. So you could actually say that this is equal to 0 of t times, or sorry, the integral of 0 to t of f of t minus tau times g of t d tau, and that would be acceptable as well. So you can substitute t minus tau into either your f of t function or your g of t function. It doesn't matter, you just need to pick one of them. So you should pick whichever one seems like it would be easier to perform the substitution into. In this case, obviously that's g of t, because we have to just substitute t minus tau for t into g of t, really easy, instead of sine of 1/2 times t minus tau. It just gets a little more complicated. So that's all we have to do to plug into our convolution integral. And now, this is our inverse Laplace transform function. We can just simplify a little bit. We'll just call this 3 cosine of t over 2 minus 14 sine of t over 2 plus 1/2 times the convolution integral from 0 to t of sine of t over 2 times g of t minus tau d tau. And that's it. That's our final answer.
So I hope you found this video helpful. If you did, like this video down below and subscribe to be notified of future videos.